Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh our Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity into this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Tinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated into the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and Canada in certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we teach by the true and correct names and title for the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true and correct name for the Father is Yahweh. It had been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It had been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifest in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been improperly substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lord's many and God's many. But we now know each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language since some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible rendering for the true and correct name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state he is inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh in pure spirit is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Just as you see, this fiery cloud has been drawn to extend all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart abides within this cloud. In like matter, everything in the creation and the sum total of the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man cannot perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form within himself as Elohim. This is the Word, our Son. A superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface to the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up your one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law of the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and minor practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning, ordained. There is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Joshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Joshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We have a prayer this morning by Dr. Joe Williams, a scripture lesson of 2 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter, by Dr. LeBron Harden. And after the prayer and scripture, we'll have a song by Lisa
Zaidi.
From they know I'm bad with last name. So Lisa, the girl, okay, that's visiting us today.
From Tampa.
Okay.
There you go.
I can't even pronounce my name right half the time. And get the mic. Oh, it ain't working?
Let's all bow our hearts in prayer.
It would probably be better if you put it on unless you keep it up close to you.
All righteous Father Yahweh, we'd like to thank you once again for allowing us to assemble ourselves one more time to learn about your divine purpose and your pattern and plan of salvation. We ask that you still our hearts and you put thanksgiving in our hearts. We ask that we want to thank you for the many blessings that you've bestowed upon us as we sojourn on this earth plane. We ask that you rent the veil of the flesh in our consciousness and give us eyes that we may see you, Father, as you really are and as you actually exist. We ask that you inspire the speakers today, that they bring forth the words of eternal life, that we always see you as you really are and actually exist. We ask that you continue to give this class strength and give us guidance and give us direction. We know that you, Father, and only you deserve all the honor and the glory and the praise. We ask all these blessings in your only begotten Son's name, Yahshua Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Morning, class.
Good morning.
This morning, I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible, containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically comparing with ancient authorities of various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainer, an Italian Jew from the Scripture Research Association, and reprinted by Yahshua Promotions. I'll be reading 2 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter, which you can find on the back of your Holy Name Bible on page 239. Do we begin again to commend ourselves, or need we, as some others, epistles of condemnation to you, or letters of condemnation from you? Letters of epistles of commendation to you, or letters of commendation from you? We are our epistle written in our hearts, known and read of all men. For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of the Messiah, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the spirit of the living Elohim, not in the tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart. And such confidence have we through the Messiah towards Yahweh, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of Yahweh, who also hath made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. But if the ministration of death, written and engraven in stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses, for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect, by reason of the glory that excelleth. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious. Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech, and not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. But their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the readiness of the whole, of the Old Testament.
The reading.
I don't know. What's wrong with me today? I'm sorry. In the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away with in the Messiah. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when they shall turn to Yahweh, the veil shall be taken away. Now, Yahweh is spirit, and where the spirit of Yahweh is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of Yahweh, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of Yahweh. I have read 2 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter. Let us all say,
Amen. Amen. Amen.
I'm the choir director in the Tampa, Florida class. This song is written and composed by Dr. Judith Turner, who is our vice president. And it's about the creation and how it shows forth Yahweh's name, specifically how the waves come in and out Yahweh.
Yahweh, Yahweh, Yahweh.
Okay, this morning we're going to try to have a two-speaker format. And our first speaker this morning will be Dr. Terry Welch.
We are nearing the end of the visit that we've had here for almost 2 weeks in Southern California. And I sincerely want to thank Dr. Joe Williams for everything he's done to make this really, really, really beneficial and easy and accessible and all that kind of stuff. It's just been wonderful. So he's done wonderfully. And you have made a difference not only for us but for others in the process. So, and I assume you know that, but it's an absolute fact, and so I do want to acknowledge it. It is important that we do help the brethren to do things that are in line with Yahshua's will, and when we can promote the things that really help get Yahshua's gospel across and the love of the Messiah to the brethren, it is a wonderful thing. So I appreciate it. with respect to the scripture that was read, we'll talk about a few things in conjunction with that. Let's just go into the scripture and then we'll add a few points in as we go through.
You want to start
to whoever, three or start one. Right at one, that would be great.
Okay, maybe I can read it better this time. Do we begin again to commend ourselves, or need we, as some others, epistles of commendation to you, or letters of commendation from you?
Now, these letters of commendation that he's talking about, these would be like letters from somebody considered to be an authority that's like a recommendation, okay? You know how, like, if you apply for a job, somebody doesn't know who you are, they want you to bring letters of recommendation. Well, when it comes to the teaching and when it comes to spiritual things, he's going to talk about the only letters that are necessary, and they're not letters that are written with pen and ink, not letters from an individual that says, oh, Dr. Will Williams is a great guy, you know what I'm saying? You don't need that from somebody, all right? And Dr. Kinley, who not only founded the Institute, but who has really communicated the things from the Creator Yahweh, because Yahweh gave him total panoramic, stupendous vision for the purpose of teaching and giving the revelation to others, talked about the fact that we read you as soon as you open your mouth. In other words, the words that are spoken and the deeds that are done, the words and the acts are manifestations of what's going on inside, okay? So now when somebody comes around and says that you need to worship the Buddha, you know something's wrong. When somebody comes along and even says that you need to know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you know something's wrong there too, okay? And to those people that believe in the Buddha, what I just said is going to be offensive and shocking. They're not going to agree with it. To those people that believe in Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, what I just said is going to be shocking and offensive. And I don't mean it to be offensive, but I do mean it to get a person's attention And then hopefully that person will open their mind to something that will then allow the truth to be shown, and I can be real nice about it, in a better, more clear way. Okay? Now, there is a difference between all the images, the ideas that are traditionally attached to Jesus Christ as a personal Savior and Yahshua the Messiah. Yahshua the Messiah should not have in your mind the same image as the idea of Jesus Christ, the personal Savior. Okay? There's a lot of contrasts. And no, the two names, Jesus and Yahshua, are not two alternative names, like alternative facts. Yeah. They are not two alternative names for the same person. They really bring with those names an image, an idea of who it is, and those two things are very, very different. We want you to have a clear view and a correct image of who the Creator is and who the Savior is. And that's not it for the purpose of offending, it's for the purpose of helping somebody see clearly. Okay? Now, like it or not, okay, we all know this inside, even though sometimes we kind of want to hedge on it. There is right, there is wrong. Okay. There is truth, and anything other than truth isn't the truth. Yahshua said, I'm one of the ways, one of the truths, and one of the lives. You can do it 13 or 14 different ways, as long as you choose one and choose the church of your choice. Obviously, he didn't say that. Okay? I'm being very facetious. Okay? He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes unto the Father except how?
By
him. Okay? By Yahshua. All right? So, we don't get to choose who Yahshua is. And then people talk about the name Yahweh, Yahshua. Well, yeah, that was the Jews' name for God. All right, so you're telling me that, let's see, the Jews get to name God, and somebody else like you or I get to name God something different. Well, it doesn't make any difference what you call it. Where do you read that in the Bible? Where do you read that, if, you know what I'm saying? And then God has 72 names. That's another one that's become real popular here in the last few years. God has 72 names. No, that's not true. He doesn't have 72 names. And even the word God is not really the best, most appropriate way to refer to him. Okay? Now, people may call him, and he may be written about being called upon in 72 different ways, but he only has one name. Now, how do you know that? It's the name he gave. He only gave one name for himself. And he said, I'm Yahweh, that's my name and my glory, I will not give to another. So now, you get to name God whatever you want to when you create God. When you create or bear your children, you get to name them, right? Do your children get to change your name and call you just anything they want? And he has, and our wife said, they get the beat down. Right? Okay? So the same principle is true. Okay? It's not a matter, the truth is not a matter of opinion. Popular opinion, democratic vote, majority rule. It's not. The truth is what comports or complies with the Creator himself, period. Okay, all right, so now. So he says, as far as these kinds of things, do we need somebody else to write a letter of recommendation saying that, yep, this person is a good guy, or even saying, stay away from that one? You shouldn't need that. If you are really reading with the Spirit, if you know and understand the truth, you ought to be able to recognize in someone else what's true and what isn't. And lest we get a little bit too judgmental, let me say this. I don't recall meeting anyone other than Dr. Kinley who didn't get something wrong. And even he talked about the fact that he must have made some blunders along the way. Okay? And he made it very clear that after he received the vision of Revelation, he understood that prior to that, prior to receiving the revelation directly from Yahweh, he said it this way, that he had never had a good thought about God in his life. Now, if that was true with him, you know, it's pretty arrogant for you or I to think better of ourselves. Make sense? And that also means that even once Yahweh has shown you the truth and you know the truth, that doesn't mean you know everything about the truth. You still have misconceptions, deficiencies, things to learn.
Right.
Make sense?
Yes.
And I mention this because it's really, really easy to get set in our ways. Okay? And once we completely close our mind, well, hey, if you end up really closing your mind and not really considering things, then you stagnate. And we are supposed to continue to grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah. Isn't that the way it is in the scriptures? Okay? All right? And you're not going to grow if you don't learn. Okay? And you're not going to learn if your mind is closed. Make sense? Okay? So it's a challenge. Okay? So he says, do we need, as some others, epistles of commendation to you or letters of commendation from you? Okay, please continue.
Ye are our epistle.
Okay, now Paul as an apostle is writing to these individuals who are going to be sent out, and when Paul wrote, what he was saying was he was writing by the words he spoke, and those things in the spirit were written in the hearts and minds of the individuals who would then go out. Paul didn't need to write them letters of recommendation to go to the assemblies that Paul had been to. Okay? Anybody that went out, the folks should have been able to hear those folks and judge for themselves. Okay? All right. He says, so you are our epistle. And where are you written? Please read.
Ye are our epistle, written in our hearts, known and read of all men.
Right.
For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of the Messiah, ministered by us, mm-hmm. written not with ink, but with the spirit of the living Elohim.
So now when Yahweh prophesied back in Jeremiah, we could read it, but Jeremiah 31, 31 through 34, when he prophesied through Jeremiah back there, he said he was going to be the one to write the New Testament. Okay? He didn't say Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Peter, Paul, any of those people were going to write the New Testament. He says he would write the New Testament. And where did he say he was going to write it? In the hearts and in the minds of those who he caused to believe. Okay? And then in the scriptures, I think it's in Psalms 45, he says that his tongue is the pen of a ready writer. So with the speaking, with the preaching of the gospel, the Holy Spirit, which is the Holy Spirit in you, is the New Testament. The Holy Spirit should be writing in your heart and in your mind in a way that is comparable by pattern, but better on the level than the way Yahweh wrote up here. Now here, let me explain, okay, what I just said, what I was thinking about as I was talking about. When Yahweh spoke his commandments from Mount Sinai, what happened simultaneously with him speaking? The moment he spoke to Israel the commandments from Mount Sinai, what happened?
He wrote on tables of stone.
That's correct. Yahweh wrote the commandments on the tables of stone up here in Mount Sinai. Okay? And as he spoke, his tongue, in principle, wrote indelibly in those tables of stone the same words that he was speaking. So there was the verbal and the visual. These were visible once they were brought back down. Okay? In other words, this was a manifestation as well as the words that they heard. And that happened when Yahweh spoke. So now that sets up a pattern or a precedent. And that was at the beginning of the Old Testament or the Old Covenant. A covenant is an agreement, an arrangement, a contract, a binding agreement. And this was made as a marital contract or covenant, sacred covenant. And it was dedicated with blood, okay? And so when Yahweh spoke it back here, he spoke it by him speaking and them hearing, and him writing in tables of stone, okay? Now, the new covenant would be written by the same pattern or following the same format, the same precedent. How would that happen and when would that happen? Well, on the day of Pentecost, in the year that would have been the 34th birthday of the Messiah. Okay, by the way, a lot of times we say, when we talk about the day of Pentecost, we are thinking of only one day throughout history. And that was the day that's shown here, okay, when they did receive the Holy Spirit. But Pentecost was an annual festival. It was a feast of weeks that was done every year from the year that Yahweh made the old covenant for all those years after that down through here. And it was on that particular day, on this date, which would have been the 34th birth date of the Messiah, okay, which is very similar to June the 6th. Okay, it's actually technically Sivan 6 in that calendar. Okay. But in any case, on that particular day, what Yahweh did was write a new covenant. And he did it by speaking the Holy Spirit into the hearts and minds of those who received and believed in him on that particular day. That made in their hearts and minds a permanent writing, which was the reality of what this permanent writing is. You know, you say when you write something in stone, the idea is it's permanent, right? It's not like writing with a pencil that you can erase and then this, and that means it's permanent, okay? So when he wrote in their heart or mind on the day of Pentecost by preaching the gospel, that was the permanent gift of the Holy Spirit in them, okay? And this was the reality of the New Testament or New Covenant, which this one back here was a type and shadow prefiguring the new one. Okay? So now Paul is using that same kind of thing in this scripture here. And he says, you are our epistle, and you're written in our hearts, and you're known and read of all men. And then he says, for as much as you are manifestly declared to be the epistle of who?
The Messiah.
The epistle of the Messiah. Not the epistle of Paul or Peter or John or whatever. Because again, it's the Messiah who, or the Holy Spirit. And the name of the Holy Spirit is Yahshua, who was and is the Messiah. Okay, so with the epistle of the Messiah, he says, but that epistle was ministered by us. In other words, administered. Make sense? Now, I'll give you an example of exactly how that would have taken place back here. Okay, Yahweh showed Moses all kinds of things up here in Mount Sinai for 40 days and 40 nights twice. Twice. That's a long time. You would have to be in class 3 days a week, 2 hours a day, into your seventh year for you to have parked your physical body here as long as Moses was up here communicating with the Creator. And this was spirit to spirit, soul to soul, without the mediation of some physical person and sound waves and the ability to try and form words that communicate thoughts and ideas. You follow me? This was direct communication. You'd have to be here almost 7 years to even be here physically, as long as Moses was up there in Mount Sinai. Okay? Anyway, but when Yahweh showed that to Moses, Moses came back down and he wrote or had written Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Now, let me ask you a question. Do you think that Moses, by his own hand, penned every portion of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy?
No.
No, he did not. How was it done?
70 elders.
He dictated it. And then there were scribes which means writers. That's what scribe means. Writers. There were writers that wrote it down.
Selected.
That's right. And they were selected. That, right. It was specific. Right. Exactly. So what they did, they administered. Follow me? They were the administrator. Like if you're an office administrator, the boss tells you what to do, and then you carry it out. Well, Moses is serving in that capacity. He's giving the words and the instructions to the folks, and then they're carrying it out. So Paul's using that same kind of thing. He says, so as much as you're manifestly declared to be the epistle of the Messiah. But Paul was one that had spoken it, tutored them in it. So he says, you were administered by us. Make sense?
Yeah.
Please continue.
For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistles of the Messiah, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the spirit of the living Elohim,
right.
Not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart.
So he's doing a comparison, a contrast. No, not written in tables of stone, but where is it written? In the fleshly tables of the heart, in fulfillment of what Yahweh had prophesied in Jeremiah. Please continue.
Fourth verse. And such confidence have we through the Messiah toward Yahweh. Not that ye are sufficient of ourselves.
Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to do what?
To think anything of ourselves.
Right. In other words, we didn't do it on our own. Anything that we're able to do, anything that we know, anything that we're able to communicate, anything that we're able to carry out, in reality, it is really the Spirit operating in us
that's
causing it to happen. Now, I realize that's something that we're not on a regular basis conscious of. And part of what is important is to become conscious of that. And in truth, it's not only the Spirit operating in us, it's the Spirit operating in everything in the universe, because in reality, everything is Spirit materialized.
That's right.
And it's materialized according to a predetermined divine pattern, which determines the operation within the pattern or the function that everything is going to be carried out. So you're a little piece of the whole puzzle, and you fit in the exact way that the Creator predetermined. And everything else has to fit too, otherwise it's like cogs in a wheel, and if they don't match, if the cogs in the wheel don't line up, what happens with the mechanism?
It
just stops, it breaks down, the whole thing doesn't work. Yahweh's machine works. Okay, so every one of us can be considered as like cogs in a wheel, or members of a body, or parts of the whole, see? And each of us are just simple little pieces. And it's not my responsibility to know everything about you, your little piece, your little role, okay? Including the good things that you do and the mistakes that you do. Make sense?
Yes.
And that's both. You are going to make mistakes. With the Holy Spirit, you're going to make mistakes.
That's right.
Yeah.
And if you don't, you won't learn from them.
That's right.
And people seem to think,
if you got the Holy Spirit, you're absolutely ideal in every way.
No.
No.
No. He talks about that all together we will grow up. We together will grow up into a perfect man. To the measure of the stature of the fullness of the Messiah. But it's not that I as an individual am a perfect or complete man that have measured up to the stature of Yahshua the Messiah. Follow me? I'm a piece. And I fit into the process. And you know something? Sometimes I've got to make mistakes. And you know, sometimes those mistakes help me learn. Sometimes they might help somebody else learn too.
That's right.
Okay? And instead of taking the attitude, boy, did he screw up. Boy, that guy's just a jerk. And leaving it at that, you might say, boy, did he screw up. And that shows me what not to do. Okay? So, same kind of thing there, okay? All right. So, in other words, we're in this together, but it's all coordinated and operated by a spirit that we can trust. Okay? But you gotta learn to trust him. Now, you don't even do that on your own. You learn to trust him or have faith in him by experience. You don't learn to trust him and have faith in him just through personal effort. In other words, you should study and learn all you can. But this is more than an intellectual exercise.
This is true.
It is not something that is supposed to stay in your head. It's supposed to permeate your entire being, and that has to happen through experience. Okay? Now that principle is true in every phase of life. I do training and instruction professionally and have done it for 30 some years. Okay? And one of the things I find is that when it comes to training in an area that requires actual skill, not just answering something on a test, you know what I'm saying? When the test comes down to actually doing something, people not only need to have knowledge, but they need to end up with the practical application of the knowledge, the skills. So there's a difference between education and training. There's a difference between knowledge and understanding, okay? And it requires experience, and sometimes the experience comes over a period of time at a cost, okay? It does. And part of that is making mistakes, but not just saying, oh, well, made a mistake, I don't care. It's like, oh boy, made a mistake. How do I do that better next time? Mm-hmm. Make sense? Now, there's illustrations in the scriptures I could give you, but I've got a very, very, very short period of time, okay? So if I illustrated it, gave you the demonstrations and so forth in the scriptures, it'd burn up the rest of the clock, but they're there. Continue, please.
Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of Yahweh.
Yahweh is the only one that makes us whole, and we are whole and entire or perfect in him. He fulfills us. What our need is fulfilled by Yahshua, just like the Jews need to obey the commandments of Yahweh was fulfilled by Yahshua. Let me say it this way. Yahshua did for the Jews what the Jews could not do for themselves.
That's right.
And that was to fulfill Yahweh's law and commandments. Mm-hmm. On a spiritual level, Yahweh, as Yahshua, as the Holy Spirit, does for you and in you what you cannot do for yourself. And that is to fulfill the spiritual need that Yahweh had put in you to become one with him.
Right.
Make sense? The Jews' perfection was in Yahshua instead of as individuals. And as long as they were fighting for individual perfection, they were rejecting the perfection or fulfillment of Yahshua. The same is true with you and me. Okay? Yes, you want to and you should become perfect. And the expression, be all that you can be? Mm-hmm. Absolutely, absolutely. But you should be all that you can be in Yahshua, and you've got to depend on him to make that happen. Period. And just simply be conscious of how he's doing it. Okay?
Right.
Sometimes be a little patient with yourself. Because you're not going to... you're not going to be all that you will be right now. In fact, look, if we're going to go on, Dr. Kinney talked about this, we're going to go on learning of Yahweh in ages to come, right? Mm-hmm. Well, if we're going to learn of him in ages to come, that means as long as you are in this age and in these physical bodies, you're not going to learn everything.
That's right.
Makes sense.
Otherwise, wouldn't be anything left for him to be teaching you in the next age. And I really think that what we are learning now is a small smidgen of the totality, and I've got an example of that that kind of has, to me, made this kind of an experiential thing. Okay, when you are a child and you learn about numbers, okay, you typically learn to count first, right? And you have a physical object as a referent. And here's what I mean: one, 3. Now I used a word, or words, 1, 2, 3, right? And what I'm trying to communicate is an idea, a principle, an abstract, you can call it a concept. But I also gave you something visual and tangible to relate it to. Now, when I said 1, 2, 3, I didn't say finger, finger, finger. And the point was not finger, finger, finger. The point was for you to be able to see the individual physical manifestations of a principle. 1, 2, 3, and to hear it. To hear it, to see it, and then to be able to draw out the principle from it, and that takes repetition. So one of the ways to do that is give multiple examples, okay? I'll use 3 fingers. The next time I'll use 3 apples. Follow me? The next time it's 3 cars. The next time it's 3 people. And eventually it clicks and you, oh, I get it. Follow me? He's not talking about fingers or apples or people. He's talking about the principle.
Right.
Now that's what is involved with this pattern. This pattern is an assemblage of principles that is put together in a very specific way. That's what the embodiment of the Creator, Yahweh Elohim, actually is. Okay? And we're learning about something abstract by taking that which is concrete. We're taking the natural to understand the spiritual. Okay? Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, now you understand the idea of counting 1, 2, 3. Then later on, you learn to do calculations. And instead of going, okay, if you have 2 sets of 3, how many do you have? Now you learn to do that by first counting 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Okay, that makes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Right? You learn it that way, and now you got the idea. Now if I say, what 3 plus 3, what is the answer?
6.
Okay, now if I do it this way, I say, well, let's say it a little different. If it's 2 times 3, what's the answer?
6.
You understand the principle. Now that you've got the precept, okay, now what I want to say, what is 3 to the 2nd power? Ah, you understand what I'm saying? Now we use another, but I'm expressing the same exact thing. Right? Uh-huh. Or, you know, 2 to the 3rd power, or those same kind of, you understand what I'm saying? That same principle,
uh-huh.
Okay? That kind of an idea. In other words, we do it that way. Now, then, here's what happens. And this happened during my generation. We got electronics and little devices called calculators. Now, I started out with a slide rule. Does anybody remember slide rules?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, I know, some of us are showing our age. Slide rule is an ingenious item, okay? Anyway, it doesn't matter how they're formed, with logarithmic, you know, distances and stuff, but that's a tool. It's a tool to learn to do calculate. Then we'd get calculators, and then we just do everything. And one of the things we found out when we depend on calculators all the time is that we kind of get rusty on our calculations.
That's right.
Okay?
Uh-huh.
Right. But then we got to the point where we're doing what we used to call, can't even think of the term because they want to replace that term now. Anyway, we used formulas, okay? And we learned how to do formulas, like just simple things that were involved with algebra, okay? And now, what they want to do is they'll give you algebra, okay? But then, when it comes to practical use of it, you don't end up doing the algebraic equations, so to speak, by hand. You end up using a calculator, or actually, what you end up using is a what? A computer. Yeah, a phone,
yeah.
Which is right.
Google.
They say there's more calculator. Oh, Google, yeah, right, exactly. Google rules the world. Okay?
Google it.
Yeah, right? Okay. So, anyway, now that there are computers, supercomputers, they can do, and somebody else knows this kind of stuff far more than me, but tell me, what is the number of calculations that a supercomputer can do each second now? Anybody know what some of the top end are?
Nope.
It's like hundreds of thousands, right? at least, okay? I can't do hundreds of thousands of calculations every second. In fact, if you have me do hundreds of thousands of calculations, it'll probably gonna take me a couple of weeks, right? But supercomputer, boom, it's all done. Make sense? Okay, going into the next age, to me, is probably going to be like going from the age of counting on your fingers to the age of supercomputers. Because the supercomputers work with the invisible electronics. They don't have the physical, tangible reference that have to be physically moved and manipulated from one place to another. And in the next age, you're not going to have a physical body that has to be moved and manipulated from one place to another. It's going to be all spiritual. Follow me? And boom! Okay? So in other words, the point of all that is, what we're going to be learning of Yahweh in ages to come is going to be so much more and so much faster that you would not in this age even be able to comprehend what it's going to be like there. It's just like you couldn't do all those algorithms, they call them, okay, that they put in the computers. You can't do it. Okay? And that's the way it's going to be in the next age. It's going to be going to like a supercomputer computational algorithmic state from where we are now is counting on our fingers. Okay? It's a great thing. Point I'm making behind all that is this. What we're learning is the most wonderful thing that there possibly can be. And it prepares us for this age and the rest of our life here. But it also prepares us, more importantly, for the next age and eternal life. And you, in that kind of a comparison, you can see why you got to become prepared now. Right? Because if you had no idea what a computer was, you had no idea what it is, period. Okay? And somebody handed you a computer, would you be able to use it? Okay? You don't even know what it is, and I hand you my laptop, you wouldn't even be able to get into it, because you got to have a passcode. You understand what I'm saying? That's exactly the way, to me, it's going to be like in the next age. Yahweh's going to be handing you a spiritual body. Super computational ability beyond anything you've ever experienced in this age whatsoever. You have not done that yet. But if you aren't prepared with some basic fundamental knowledge of how to at least learn to use it, you're going to be stuck. Yeah. Make sense? And that's the way it is. So we're learning now, but we're prepared to learn much more. And Yahweh is doing that by bringing us up now. So you shouldn't quit learning in this age. Don't think, I got this. You understand what I'm saying? I got this now. I got this teaching. Oh, yeah. It's all mastered now. As soon as you do that, you shut yourself out. Okay? All right. Continue reading. I hope the principle got across there. Continue.
Who also hath made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit.
The New Testament is not literal, it's spiritual. Please read.
For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life.
When Yahweh gave them the literal carnal ordinances back here, it was never designed to give them life. It was designed to kill them. I'll say it again, and I want you to understand what I meant. When Yahweh gave them the literal law of carnal ordinances back there, those ordinances were never designed to give them life. It was designed to kill them.
Right.
Mm-hmm. This law was never intended to make them righteous.
That's right.
Now, they had to try and fail.
Yep.
And when you read in the scriptures, like in Deuteronomy, it's the people, not Yahweh, it's the people saying, it shall be our righteousness if we do all the things that Yahweh has commanded. They couldn't do it. And Yahweh gave him 1,500 years, 1,490 years, until Messiah came in, to try it. And he even separated them out from the corrupting influence of the Egyptians and the other nations for the first 40 years of OJT. You understand? Gave them out of the job training for 40 years here in the wilderness, separated out from the concerns of the other nations, the corruptions there. And not one of them in 1,490 years was able to be righteous. And yet they still had the arrogance during the days of Yahshua the Messiah to hold to the idea that they were so special and they were so righteous because they knew the things that were written down in the scriptures. You can quote all kinds of things. It doesn't mean you understand it. Okay? And that was the situation back there. So, here's the point. What Yahweh did by giving them the law was convict them of sin. What he did was to cause it to make sin exceedingly sinful. In other words, they couldn't get around it with excuses. You follow me? And that's what people try to do constantly. Okay? Instead of saying, I screwed up, I'm sorry, I'll try and make amends, I'll try and do better, okay? But I did, I messed up, okay? That wasn't the attitude that they ended up having. It was still, I can be righteous, I can be righteous. No, the lesson of the Old Testament commandments should have been, we can't do it. There is nobody able to do it except there is someone that has been promised to do it on our behalf. And when he does, I will place all of my hope and faith and trust in him. Now, under the New Testament, folks, because you weren't under the Old Testament, you were never under those Ten Commandments. Unless you're a physical, natural Jew born before Pentecost. Okay? Yeah, right. Let me count, right? Yeah, let me count the years. Okay. So, but under the New Testament, the message still should be comparable to that, and that is this. I still cannot, of my own individual efforts, works, volition, cannot come up to the level of perfection or completion on my own. In fact, in reality, I can't even make my heart beat. And you get to a point to where hopefully you end up being broken down to the point to where you realize you can't think anything, do anything, even get out of bed in the morning without Yahshua causing it to happen. And he's causing it to happen for his purposes.
That's right.
And because it's his purpose, you can trust he's going to follow through with it.
That's it.
You don't have to beg and plead. He's already got to take care of it. You understand what I'm saying?
That's right.
And you're just going, thank you, Yahshua. So in other words, it should inspire faith and trust. Once you see the Holy Spirit truthfully operating in you. And please don't make the mistake that a lot of people make and pretend to be with the Holy Spirit. People do that. They do it too much. Way too much. You see great illustrations of that that many of you mock. And my wife has told me stories about, you know, because when she grew up in these churches that were, what's the word for them? They call them a holiness and...
Pentecostal.
Sanctified, right? You know, and she saw people get the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, amen. Jesus came in and he threw babies up in the air. Uh-huh. Jesus! Throw babies up in the air, literally. Now, that ain't no Holy Spirit. Do you understand what I'm saying? But you can't tell those people that wasn't the Holy Spirit.
Right.
Okay.
And you can mock it all you want. To them, that's real. And many of us do the same exact thing in this institute. Mm-hmm. And I know that's going to sound offensive, but it's a fact.
That's right.
And it is a fact that we need to become conscious and aware of and know the difference. And the whole point is here, not to put something down, build something up. The point is to learn and understand what's true and what isn't.
Right.
Okay? Don't be pretending to have the Holy Spirit. You can screw yourself up for all eternity doing that. That can become blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, which Joshua said wasn't forgivable in the prior age or in this age. So anyway, don't do that. But once you actually and truthfully and honestly see and recognize and know the Holy Spirit operating in yourself and others, you better respect it and still recognize that you and the other person are not as individuals all that there is. Make sense?
Yes.
Okay? I hope that's helpful. All right, continue.
Seventh verse. But if the ministration of death, written and engraven in the stones, was glorious.
Now he's talking about the Old Testament commandments written and engraved in these tables of stone. Please read.
So that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away.
Stop. Let me explain what that is. Many of you know already, but what they're talking about is this. When Moses came back down from the mountain that third time, and he brought these tables of stone down, second set, showing the second covenant, okay, in a type, Moses, it says this, that Moses' face, the skin of his face, shone or shined so much that he had to put a veil over his face when he went to talk with the children of Israel. And Paul, you're going to pick up a little phrase here that I hope will help you to understand something. And this is where I was kind of trying to go right from the beginning on this. And I'll explain when we get there. Moses' face shone so much, and that was a glory. The word glory means shining or brightness. Okay? And so Moses' face was shining with brightness or with glory. Now, I guess I got to explain where that came from. Was that just a happy face? Okay, Moses was definitely happy, but that wasn't a happy face. That wasn't the point. What was that shining brightness? That was the Spirit. Specifically how? Do you know? Okay, let me go back to something. A scripture that everybody in the Institute has read or had read to them probably 10,000 times. Okay? So I'm going to take a moment to do this, okay? Sometimes I rush, and I'm going to try and make this clear. Don't lose your place there, but some one of you, would you please go back to Exodus 24, 9 and 10.
Exodus 24, 9. Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel.
This is a picture showing that thing right here. They went up on the plateau of the mount, and they did what?
And they saw the Elohim of Israel.
So here's this vision of Yahweh Elohim. They saw him in a vision. They saw the Elohim of Israel. Okay? Now, listen to what is described about what they saw. Please read.
And there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone.
Okay? You see that depicted here.
And as it were, the body of heaven in its clearness.
Okay, stop. Do you know what the word clearness means?
Invisible?
No.
No.
No. Doesn't mean that at all. And that's part of the reason I'm making a point of this. All you got to do is look this up in the Strong's Concordance. And I'll tell you something right now. This is the only place in the entire King James Bible that word is used. That the word clearness is written. Okay? And it means brightness or brilliance. This was a bright, shining body that outshone the noonday sun. This was a body of heaven in all his glory or brightness or shining splendor.
Yeah.
That's what it was. And if you read down here when Joshua fulfilled it, you read it in Matthew the 17th chapter, Luke the 9th chapter, Mark the 9th chapter, about when Joshua transfigured before them. He's fulfilling, and it says in the one place that his clothing was so white and glistering that, and it was white and bright, so much so that no fuller, which is like a laundry expert, okay, no fuller on earth could brighten it. In other words, you can't bleach it and make it that bright. His body outshone the noonday sun. His body outshone the noonday sun. The temple was an example, a physical manifestation of the principle of a glorified spiritual body, and the polished golden dome of that temple at noontime when the sun shone on it, you couldn't even bear to look directly on that because of the brightness that was there. This body was bright beyond anything that was earthly. It was a heavenly body, a body of heaven, not an earthly body or a human body. Human means taken from humus or from the earth. It was not an earthly body. The first Adam was of the earth, earthly. He was human. The last Adam was Yahshua from where?
Heaven.
From heaven. His body is glorious. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Beyond the glory of the angels. In fact, the angels got their brightness or glory from him. Just like plants, green plants and red plants and all these beautiful colors of these plants get all their color from the reaction to the sunlight. Okay? The sun is the source. This is the sun. This is only a dark manifestation of the sun. Okay? So, this bright body right here was what they saw. All right? Moses was up there communing spirit to spirit with him for 40 days and 40 nights twice. This shone in him. You understand what I'm saying? And when he came back down, he was so infused with the glory of Yahweh that it permeated and shone through Moses. Now, the little, I'm probably not going to have time to go into all the detail of this mystery. We'll get to what we can get to. Continue on reading in 2 Corinthians 3. Okay? Go ahead.
8 verse. How shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glory?
So in other words, if this glory, this brightness back here was great, that's only a type and shadow compared with the ministry of the Spirit. Okay? Much greater. Please read.
For if the ministration of condemnation be glory.
This covenant brought condemnation. And if that ministry brought glory, go ahead.
Much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory.
Then the ministration of righteousness under the New Testament, the glory under the New Testament exceeds or far excels beyond anything that this type and shadow was. Please continue.
For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect,
mm-hmm.
by reason of the glory that excelleth.
Mm-hmm.
For if that which is done away was glorious,
and the Old Testament was done away in Yahshua the Messiah. Go ahead.
Much more that which remaineth is glorious.
And that's the Spirit. Go ahead.
Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech.
Yes, now we speak mysteries of Yahweh and speak them openly and plainly. Okay? And here's the thing. What Dr. Kinley taught, and what you as a result of that teach, and what I as a result of that teach, and what you and I are privileged to be part of, folks, you ought to recognize could not have come from a man's mind. Now, once you know that, once you recognize that, you ought to go, thank you, Yahshua. You shouldn't need somebody to write a letter to say, this is right.
That's right.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Please continue.
13th verse.
Mm-hmm.
And not as Moses.
And this is the part I wanted to get to.
Which put a veil over his face.
Not as Moses, who did what? Put that veil over his face for what reason?
That the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished.
Stop. The reason Moses put a veil over his face was so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. Is that what it says?
Yes.
Here's my question. What is that? What is it that's abolished? And that's what she said it correctly. The Old Testament. The law of carnal ordinances. How do you know? Put a finger where you're at and go over to Ephesians 4:15. I'll try and do that as quickly as possible. I don't even see it.
Ephesians 4 and 15.
Yes.
But being truthful in love, ye may grow up into him.
No, it's not.
You are King James?
Now, I may have called the wrong scripture. I'll just tell you what it says. Take your time.
Yeah.
Look it up when you get home. Yahshua is talking about, and he says he has abolished in his flesh even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, therefore making of two one new man, so making peace. But it says about Yahshua, he abolished in his flesh.
2:15.
Not 4:15, I apologize.
Ephesians 2 and 15.
Mm-hmm.
Having abolished in his flesh the enmity.
The enmity.
Even the law of the commandments contained in ordinances.
Yes.
For to make in himself of twain one new man, so mankind peace.
So making peace. So he, Yahshua, abolished in his flesh the enmity, which was the law of commandments contained in ordinances. You follow me? Now, that's what Paul is referring to back in 2 Corinthians. The third chapter. Okay? Moses put a veil over his face so the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. What is abolished? The law of commandments contained in ordinances. Make sense? So here's the point. If Moses had not concealed or veiled what he saw up here in this vision, then even the children of Israel could have seen Yahshua come in, fulfill the Old Testament, die, bury, resurrect, ascend, and pour out the Holy Spirit, making a new covenant and abolishing the old covenant. And that proves right there, Moses saw Yahshua die, bury, resurrect, and ascend. And there's other scriptures like Luke 9, I think 13th verse or something like that, that you have to put with it. Because it shows here the transfiguration. That Moses and Elijah talked with Yahshua in this vision, which really is this vision, about Yahshua's decease, which Yahshua should accomplish at Jerusalem. Moses saw and understood these things about Yahshua, but he had to veil it or conceal it, because otherwise the children of Israel
would know,
and that was a mystery to be hidden for that time. Anyway, I hope that's of some value. Praise Yahshua the Messiah.
Hallelujah.
Our next speaker this afternoon will be the Dean of the School, Dr. Joe Williams.
Class. It's a pleasure and an honor to stand before the assembly of Yahshua Messiah and testify some of the things that Yahweh allowed me to see and understand about this great teaching. So far, I think we had a pretty good class today. I've enjoyed the song, I enjoyed the first speaker, I enjoyed messing with the mic and all that kind of stuff, you know, having technical difficulties. But at the end of the day, here we are. All right? Now, I've had a good time with Terry for the last 10, 12 days. He's been with me since the first. We've been all around. We've been to Pomona, we've been to Banning, you see, and of course we've been here. And we've had talks. So it's been a really good time spending with him and his family. And we've been to Oceanside with Dennis Volpe down in Oceanside. But overall, it's been a good time spending with you, and I know you're going to be a short time here, a few more days, but thank you for coming and visiting, and I hope you come back and study with us again and spend some time with us. Now, I'm going to continue in some of the same principles that he talked about. Now, our first aim is to help you find and know Yahweh as he really is and as he actually exists. Not what you think and not what you imagine, what you feel, or what you heard, and what you believe. You see? Now, the founder, what he did was, he had a divine, stupendous, panoramic vision, you see, of the purpose and plan of Yahweh from start to finish. And when we talk about the Bible or we talk about the scriptures, you must keep the purpose in mind. In a nutshell, in a simple nutshell, Yahweh purposed the purpose within himself. He came down, you see, in an incorporeal state condition, you see. He manifested in the flesh as Yahshua the Messiah, fulfilling that was declared in the realm of eternity. You see, then he ascended back to the Father. Came down, you see, as Yahweh Elohim assembled a creation by the pattern. Then he came down in the flesh to fulfill and declare what he could purpose and declare the realm of eternity. And then, you see, he made a round trip. And then he dispensed grace, you see. That wasn't supposed to be like that. He dispensed grace, all right, to me and you, so that we can have an understanding of what was purposed and declared in the realm of eternity. Now, be mindful of this. And don't misunderstand this. The purpose and plan of Yahweh is complete. If that was not so, we could not stand here and talk about it. Now, I'm going to say that one more time. The purpose and plan of Yahweh is complete. If that was not so, we could not stand up here and talk about it. Now, Yahweh, you see, who is rich in mercy. And let me have real quick Colossians 1 and 12. You see, the first speaker did a good job. His rich in mercy that now, you see, he has made us fit to be partakers of his gift. That now that we can be called the sons of Yahweh. And Yahweh set this thing up so that we will find ourselves in a fallen state. And by finding ourselves in a fallen state, then maybe we might seek him and understand there's something greater than us. So what he did was, Yahweh within himself, he purposed and declared what shall be. And then he took on shape and form as Yahweh Elohim, who is the archetype or the original pattern of the universe. It was in this incorporeal state and condition whereby the first speaker talked about how the Yahweh showed Moses how he transformed, you see, into this threefold completely furnished tabernacle. And when he showed him, he talked about how that he was
glory.
Clearness.
Yes, in his clearness. And he talked about it was brilliant. You see, and how this body was glorious. Now, when he showed him this glorious body, or read it, because I'm messing it up right now. 24th chapter of Exodus. Then went up Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 elders, and they saw the Elohim of Israel. And under his feet was a paved work of a sapphire stone, as the body of heaven in its clearness. Isn't that right?
Yes.
You see, and that clearness, you see, that was that glorious body, and this was the glory of Yahweh, not the cloud. You see,
right.
He was in the midst of the cloud, but the point is, people think the glory of Yahweh was this phenomenal cloud. It was him who was controlling the cloud, and that was a pillar of a cloud by, it was a pillar of a fire by night, it was a cloud by day, and it was illuminating the children of Israel so that they can always be in light. But he was that glory. And let me say this while I'm here. Yahweh was pleased with his son.
Yeah.
And that Yahweh is both masculine and feminine within himself. It was him who in the parent's son who gave birth to his son. And in reality, it was Yahweh in a sonship degree carrying out his own purpose or the will of the Father as Yahweh Elohim. And the name of the shape and form, listen, it is Yahshua. That's why it's right up on the chart as Yahweh Elohim and Yahshua. And the man can see him in this shape and form, of course, by permission. It takes Yahweh himself to reveal himself, you see, of course, to himself. And in this respect, this is Yahweh the Father is now in shape and in form. You see, revealing himself to the man Moses as he's invited up into the mountain. And he sees how the creation comes in by the pattern, you see, being having the most holy place, the holy place, and the court round about. And as the book says, Yahweh Elohim transfigured, I'll say it like this, the founder said that Yahweh Elohim transfigured or transmuted, you see, or transform into this threefold completely furnished tabernacle, which revealed to Moses, you see, as Moses seeing the creation being assembled by the pattern. Then Moses sees after 7 days, the next 33 days, he received divine instructions on how to build and construct this tabernacle pattern, you see, and this tabernacle pattern, which was revealed to the man Moses, he brought this back down to the people. Now, as far as they were concerned, you see, Moses, who was reared up in Pharaoh's household, you see, Moses, what he doing here? He killed a man, you see, but that was all according to the purpose. Now, in that Moses, you see, killed a man, come down here and deliver these folks out of the land of Egypt, and I'm telling you, there was nothing righteous in those folks at that time. And let me say this while I'm here. Yahweh chose Moses, or he separated him from among his brethren, and we would say he sanctified him, if you will, just as Yahweh Elohim was sanctified. The word sanctified means to be separate and set apart from. So he made an exodus, or he sanctified him, you see, in order that he may come down and do the will of the Father. And Yahweh Elohim took up residence in Adam, you see, and he revealed that to the man Moses. Why? So that the man could understand his origin, where he come from, where the waters come from, where the vegetation come from, where the man come from, because that's what the founder came in to do, to show us our origin, where we come from, why we behave the way that we do. What this thing is all about. What is spirit and what is the soul? Because we have no clue. And until he revealed himself to the man, I'm telling you folks, we are walking in darkness and ignorance, and there's a veil that's up. You see? But on the day of Pentecost, and what we're talking about, the New Testament was dispensed on the day of Pentecost. In that, Yahshua got on that cross, you see, and died the death. And let me tell you something here. This wasn't the first time that this happened. This happened way back here. When Yahweh, you see, who is spirit, who is in his ontological state of perfection, declared within himself, you see, to reveal himself to the man, you see, what he did was he took on a shape or form or come from behind the veil of inscrutability. And when he did that, that was a death.
That's right.
That was a death. You see, and that was the sacrifice that was prepared before the creation came in or before the foundation of the world. You see, and he's revealing to the man Moses, you see, how the creation is coming in by the pattern. You see, and as it was already brought out, he wrote on these tables of stone, you see, with his finger as he was speaking to Moses. Now, when you bring these tables of stones down, let me tell you something, folks. This had no real significance with these people until they built that doggone tabernacle. And when they built that tabernacle, they had to start offering up sacrifices. I'm letting you know, we got it right here on this chart. Oh, see, there were 12 tribes gathered around Israel. All right? And let me tell you something. There were 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances that these people had to adhere to, had to be obedient to. You see, according to Moses, what was laid down and dictated in that book. Now, when you committed a sin, it was already brought out, you see, you had to, let's say, for example, you was over here in the tribe of Ephraim. You see, you had to offer up, let's say, a bullock, a turtle dove, even a ram, maybe even some first fruits, you had to walk on down here. You follow me? All the way down, look here, from the west side, coming down north, you see, head all the way down to the east side to the gate. Now, I got my bullock, my ram, and my turtle dove, and maybe I stashed my first fruits up in here, you know, in my hand here. And I'm walking down past all you, passing all the tents. You follow me? And let me know. You know how it is with us folks, especially. They say, what the hell have Jonah done? They going to get that book? Okay. All right. We know exactly what you did. It's just like somebody catch you in a lie. You see, in the courthouse. And it's on national TV.
Oh,
you just exposed.
Really.
You see, and let me say something. You would have to kill that animal.
Yeah.
And the priest did not ask you what you did. Like they do at the Roman Catholic Church. You know, you go to confession.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Confess, I mean, you know. You tell them, you know, confess your sins, my son. And then you start to tell them all your dirty laundry. And we all got it, right? But he don't tell you his. And he got them too. You see, I ain't gonna tell you what, but I have a few things that I in mind right now. But the point is, the priest, you see, would take the blood after you killed it, you see, and put the blood on the four horns of the altar, because that was the sacrifice. You see, and when he did that, you see, there was a, after he put the four horns of the sacrifice, it was a type and a shadow, you see, of the four corners of the earth, because the man is on the earth.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is what they consider the first covenant. This would have to be done away with. Mm-hmm. Because Yahweh did not like sacrificing those animals. That's why it says, sacrifice and burnt offerings thou wouldest not. But a body that he's prepared is not so much this one. This one here, he prepared before the foundation of the earth. And then he kept, this spirit here took up residence in this physical body, because this was the only acceptable sacrifice that Yahweh prepared for himself way back here in the realm of eternity to come in to atone for man's sins, you see, because Yahweh set him up to fall. That's just the way it is. But after his death, his burial, his resurrection, and ascension, and outpouring of the Holy Spirit, we are now being made free. You see, now read Colossians.
Colossians
1 and 12. Read.
Giving thanks unto the Father.
Now giving thanks to Yahweh the Father. Read on.
Which has made us fit to be partakers.
We've been made fit, folks. You see, that's what meat means, mm-hmm. to be made fit.
Right.
We got technical difficulties again. Read, please.
To be partakers of the inheritance of the sons in light.
Read, please.
Who has delivered us from the power of darkness.
Now go back and flow down and read that again for me, please.
Who has, from the very beginning?
Yes, please. Giving thanks.
Giving thanks unto
Read.
The Father.
Read.
Which hath made us fit to be partakers of the inheritance of the sons in light.
Now, if I'm not mistaken, it says we've been made meet. Right?
Right.
That word means to be made fit, suitable, to be recipients of the gift of the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And the first speaker talked about how that these table stones, when he wrote with them with his finger, this was permanent. You see? And he also talked about how that when the Holy Spirit was poured out on the day of Pentecost, you see, that too was permanent.
Mm-hmm.
Now the founder said this, our aim and our goal is to lead you step by step toward indispensable, permanent, conscientious realization of the Spirit of Living Elohim. A permanent, conscientious realization of the Spirit of the Elohim. And I'm adding this, in you.
Right.
See, if you see him in you, that is a manifestation of the Holy Spirit. You see, and when you understand that you see him in you, then, you see, the purpose at this point is to see him in you as you. You see, when you see him in you as you, that means now that the Holy Spirit is real with you. So giving thanks to the Father who made us fit to see. Read, please.
To be partakers of the inheritance of the sons in light.
What is the inheritance? These attributes of intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. These are the attributes, you see, or the basic fundamental principles of mankind. This is Yahweh's divine makeup, and each one of these attributes is beyond the possibility of death. These attributes took on shape and form and manifest as the entire universe. That is the angelic as well as the physical creation. You see, now, you see, in this age, and what I mean by that, you see, from the fall of Adam on down to the cross, you see, these people walk in total darkness. You see, and they did not have the opportunity to receive the Holy Spirit until that last one came in, who was Yahshua Messiah, who got on that cross and dispensed grace. What is grace? Grace is unmerited favor. It's just a free gift that now we can look back, way back here in the realm of eternity, and understand how these invisible principles operate. You see, we can now understand, you see, who Yahweh Elohim and how he's carrying out his purpose. We now look back here at these events and know that it was Yahweh who was orchestrating the whole thing. We understand who the adversary is. We understand what the purpose is. We know what the soul is. We know what spirit is because now he's taking the covers off of it. You see, and now we understand now what eternal life is all about. You see, in that the Messiah himself is being formed in you. And I was so happy when he said this, that when you receive the Holy Spirit, you're still going to make mistakes. Because some people are under the false impression that once you receive the Holy Spirit, you're like all so-called righteous, and you ain't going to make no mistakes, you're not going to fall, you're not going to lie again. You get my point? What it does, you're going to fall. Because see, if you don't, you're going to think you're going to glory in the flesh. And there is no one going to ever glory in the flesh save Yahshua Messiah. And even him too, he too had to take off this body, you see, and ascend back to the Father, whereby that's the only thing in reality that exists, and that is Yahweh himself. You see, everything else is close, but now you're going to see that it is Yahweh himself who is the light. He is the water. He is the vegetation. He is the seasons in position. He is the animal kingdom, and he is also the man. That has now been made known now to you, the man, and it was all done by pattern. That pattern is the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit in an abstract state. The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit in corporeal state, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit in a corporeal state or in a physical body. This one here is visible. This one here is invisible. But it's the one Spirit in two manifestations, incorporeal and corporeal, and it's the one Yahweh who's carrying out the will of the Father, which is Yahweh himself, through his Son, Yahshua the Messiah. Y'all with me so far? Let's read, please.
13th verse. Who have delivered us from the power of darkness.
Now we've been delivered, you see, from the power of darkness. Read, please.
And have translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son.
Now we've been translated into the kingdom of Yahshua Messiah. Now hold it right there. Go back to Ephesians. You see, where the first speaker talked about, but this, I do want 4:15. Mm-hmm. You see, 4:15.
Ephesians 4:15.
Now here we are in this present kingdom age. This is where you sit. Remember, you got the end of the Luminate age, the age before the flood. You see, and then we have the post Luminate age, the age after the flood. Where we're sitting now is in the present kingdom age, whereby the Holy Spirit was dispensed in this present kingdom age. Now, we are walking in the newness of life, and now we can be partakers of his gifts or his fruits, which are these attributes being formed in us. However, before getting that, this is the problem. Let's read, please.
Ephesians 4:15.
Read on.
But being truthful in love,
read.
We may grow up into him,
read.
In all things,
read.
Which is the head,
read on.
Even the Messiah,
read.
From whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love.
Read on.
This I say, therefore, and exhort through Yahweh,
read,
that ye henceforth live not as the heathen.
Don't live as the heathens. What are the heathen?
Gentiles.
Those are the Gentiles.
As us.
Don't live as the heathens. In other words, see, they didn't have no pattern. They did not have the law. You see, they had a structure. How was it like? They was very structured on how they had to be obedient to Yahweh's laws. They had 613 statutes and judgments. They had that. However, the Gentiles, they did not have a tabernacle, and they were not under a law. You see, so he said, don't live as the heathens. Read on, please.
In the vanity of their minds.
In the vanity of their minds. Puffed up, arrogant, thinking you know. You see, read on. Just how the book says, just functioning as a natural brute beast.
Having their understanding darkened.
Read.
Being alienated from the life of Elohim through the ignorance that is in them because of the hardness of their heart.
Now hold it. Remember, Yahweh, you see, took up residence in Adam, and the woman was drawn out. Now, when the woman was drawn out, that is a principle showing forth that she was subject to vanity. We, as many, constitute the bride. And like it or not, when we're born into the world, we are subject to vanity. Come on, folks, you gotta know how kids are. They grow up and we be telling them how good looking they are, how cute they are, and they be doing all kind of stuff, and we all think it's cute. Sometimes they do stuff that offends people, which somebody think is cute. Somebody say, why did they kid do that? You get my point?
Right.
You see, but the point is, they get arrogant, you know, and get to the point that since they feel like they run around here and they getting all these accolades, you know, or this praise and so on and so forth, they think they run a doggone house all of a sudden. You know, they want to tell you what to do. Y'all know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about they subject to vanity. And then we run around talking about how cute this is, how cute that is. You get my point? I'm letting you know the woman was subject to vanity and so were you. Why? Because we take on the ways of the world just like Moses was reared up in Pharaoh's household. And see, as Adam is coming out of that garden, you see, we all died, Adam. But we lived in Adam before we died in Adam. You see? And that's what we're trying to get back to. We're trying to get to that origin where we have peace, where we have love, where we have a forgiveness for one another, in that we're willing to lay down our life for everybody. In other words, just because somebody offend you don't mean you're going to go out and offend them.
Right.
You see? Just so somebody don't like you don't mean you got to start disliking them. You see, there's always going to be somebody who dislike you and don't care about you and want to get all up in your, you know what I'm talking about. For whatever reason, just because you presented yourself, you don't start having an attitude towards them, because then you're behaving like them. You love them.
That's right.
Even though they don't love you. And what I'm saying to you is that when you subject to vanity, you see, you find yourself all puffed up.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody looking at you. And let me tell you something. She knew what the law was. Why? Because Adam told her. Mm-hmm. Don't touch, don't eat. You see, but she did partake of that fruit. And when she partook of that fruit, I'm letting you know, at that particular time, nothing happened. Why? We have a pattern. Keep in mind, folks, that with this pattern right here, you see, Yahweh himself, you see, is sitting on the throne. You see, and we got a principle here. We got Adam right here sitting on the earth plane. You see, which is the type of him sitting on the throne. We got angels that embroidered all on this veil here. And remember, in the most holy place, there was angels on the top of the veil. It was on the back of the veil. It was on the front of the veil, and on the front and back of the veil, and on the sides. You follow what I'm saying? Not on the outside, but on the inside. I'm talking about those angels embroidered here on this veil. Likewise, the fruit trees is the type of the angelic host. So here, this thing, or in this top of the chart, you see, is likened into the most holy place. So you got Michael Gabriel sitting here on the throne, just like you got Adam sitting here between two trees. So you got the pattern coming on down. So now, the woman who was a couch within the man is drawn out of the man, and just like the Ark of the Covenant, or that law was placed in the Ark, is it a type of that woman being in Adam, or she was in, how can I say it? In other words, he was her ark of safety until she was drawn out, and that's when she was subject to vanity. But when, while she was yet in him, of course, she was saved, and she was not subject, of course, to the adversary. Nevertheless, you see, we got a second departmental veil right here, you see, which is here, not here, but it is here. And that veil, you see, had to be made manifest. Remember, the principle remained the same, but the manifestation changes. So now, we have a physical veil, you see, but we're also looking for another veil. Now, in that garden, something happened. I got to draw this out real quick. Genesis 3 and 1. 3 and 2. Hey, don't lose my spot. Please. In Ephesians. I got to get back there. See, what I'm showing now is the state condition of the man back then coming out, and while we're in the state condition that we're in. Because the purpose came down, and when the purpose came down, it's because Adam, out of love for his bride, laid his life down for her. Mm-hmm. And as he came down here, in the flesh here, you see, Adam had children, you see, and one of them was Cain. You see, and Cain built a city, and that's the city of Enoch, and the founder said this, that the city of Enoch was the capital of the earth at that particular time. Mm-hmm. You see, and this was the first world dynasty, you see. And listen, from there, he had six generations who took over his kingdom, of course, down here to Nimrod. Now, Nimrod also set up, built the Tower of Babel. Now, listen, it was a satanic rule, just like here, it is a satanic rule, in that he opposed Yahweh, and so did Nimrod. He also opposed Yahweh. But there was a generation of people, you see, in a walled community, or a walled city. And guess who sat at the top? It was Nimrod posing as Yahweh. Y'all with me so far? Now, let's read, please.
Genesis 3 and 2.
Now, I want to bring her down out of this garden. Now, here, up here, remember, this is the creative age here. Read, please.
And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, Elohim has said, you shall not eat of it.
Read.
Neither shall you touch it, lest you die.
Read on.
And the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not surely die.
Now, that was not a reptile. I want to make that real clear.
Right.
Snakes don't talk. If there was a talking snake then, they got to be a talking snake now. Birds talk. And if you tell them too much, they'll tell your business. Birds, there was a talking bird then, there's talking birds now. But he's not talking about a reptile. He's talking about or describing the characteristics of a snake. To the point that sometimes you be talking to your friend, you say, you better watch Joe, you know he's a snake, right? I said, what do you mean by that? You know, he's this, he's that. You get my point, he starts giving me these negative attributes you need to look for in that person. Because he's sneaky. You see? You think you get my, I don't get to that. I'm going to run out of time. But anyway, you get my point, right?
Yeah.
All right, let's read on, please.
For Elohim does know that in the day you eat thereof,
read on,
then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as Elohim, knowing good and evil.
Now listen, she was Adam. He was Adam. She was Adam. He was Adam. He was Elohim, and she was Elohim too. And the same attributes that made him up are the same attributes that make her up. Yahweh bring us together as male and female to give birth to an offspring. You see, and that same DNA makeup from each parent makes up that offspring. Am I almost right? Likewise, when Yahweh brought the creation in, remember, when he brought the creation in, that's close to, that'll do. My point is, the DNA makeup made up the pattern, the earth plane, the atom, the cell, and so on and so forth. It all come forth from him. Everything has its origin from him. Likewise, here she come, you see, and now Lucifer, of course, is going to deceive her. But she was Adam, he was Adam. He called their name Adam. Read, please.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eye, and the tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat.
Now she ate it. Nothing happened. All right, read.
And gave it also unto her husband.
Now she gave it to him, and what happened?
And he did eat.
Now he did eat.
And the eyes of them both were opened.
Hey, look, the book says their eyes were opened. couldn't be their physical eyes, because it's not like they were looking at the doggone trees. She understood that she was deceived, hoodwinked, bamboozled. She was deceived when she put sugar, because she thought if she eat the fruit, she's going to get wise. Wisdom was part of her makeup. And she thought she gonna become something she already was, and that was wisdom. Now Adam, he knew better. And when he partook, the book says what? Their eyes were open. That is your second departmental bell. There's a change that took place. Mm-hmm. And when that change took place, as the founder said, he instantaneously died in his consciousness. Mm-hmm. Now, let me bring this home. You know how you have a girlfriend for the first time? I'm taking it home now. Boyfriend, where did y'all get together? And sometimes we just call it, you think you're in love. We call it infatuation, because you don't know that person. And then they say, it was love at first sight. That's because you read the eyeball. That's what that was all about. You see, and then she said the right things to you. You said, ooh-wee. You see what I'm saying? And you say the right things to her, and she says, oh my God, nobody said these things. You get next thing you know, you got this thing going on. Y'all feeling me? You got this passion. You see, as this passion is going on, you think you are in love, and man, I'm telling you, especially when you done kissed her for the first time, sometimes she said, my doggone legs buckle. That's because you don't know how to breathe. That's what happens. You're talking about, it was so good, my legs, but that's why you can't breathe. And then pass out, call yourself having a good time. And you know how it is when we're teenagers. Man, we make kiss for 2, 3, 4 hours. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Non-stop if nobody's watching. Isn't that right? Yeah, and we think we are in love. However, Adam and Eve, they were in love. As the founder said, they was in a state of bliss. They just was up there, and that was his bride, because Yahweh presented Adam with his bride. Because he said he could not find one that was fit, of course, for him to be with. He could be with the gorillas and the orangutan. You see, seed bears seed after his own kind. Is that almost right? You see, so you can't be bringing a gorilla up here, talking about, hey, out of here's your woman. No, seed bears seed after his own kind. Even the fruit, you get my point? My point is up here. You see, he had to get Adam out of that garden. He had to come down, and Yahweh orchestrated this whole thing. Eve, I was there like this. Adam was obedient to being old disobedient. Mm-hmm. You see, according to a purpose. You see, nevertheless, Adam and Eve was set up, listen, too far. And when she partook of the fruit and gave it to her husband, what that did was it anointed him to operate the flesh, in that it was an olive, and an olive has oil, and oil is symbolic of the spirit. So therefore, he had to bring the purpose right on down. You see, and as he's coming down, Yahweh had to drive him out. And first thing he says, read please.
After he drove him out?
Genesis, wherever you left off.
And the eyes of them both were open.
Read.
And they knew that they were naked.
They knew they were exposed. And there was one person talking to Yahweh, and that was Adam. Mm-hmm. You see? And he would tell her what to do. Yahweh said, don't eat the fruit, okay? Now, don't eat the fruit. You see? Now, if you eat the fruit, you see, you're going to die now. They don't know what death is. They have no clue what death is. Just like a little baby's running around. They run on nothing. Look, they'll run over here to the vineyard like ain't nothing going to you. They don't know anybody don't die. You tell them, don't touch the stove. They don't care about you. What the hell do you think you are? Don't touch the stove. Okay. I ain't gonna touch it no more. You get my point? But don't touch the stove. It's hot. When they touch that stove, now it's hot. Yeah, but you, I told you it was hot. Now you know what hot is. You see? You get the point? Let you know. So now she's coming on down. The purpose gotta come down. The man gotta come down out of that garden. So Yahweh orchestrated where, of course, y'all know, that woman is so powerful, boy. I tell you right now, he'll do anything you say.
That's right.
What?
Oh, yeah! Yeah, he will. I'm going to tell you what, Yahweh said, come on, man, the only true adversary on the airplane for the man is the woman. Yeah,
that's right.
You know what we're going to do with the gorilla? We're going to put his butt right up there in the doggone zoo. You see? Or the sea monster, talking about the sea, we got him in an aquarium. We feed him. Let him think we cool and everything. You see, we just have enough sense not to get in there with them, especially while they're hungry. You get the point? But the point is, Yahweh set this thing up, and he's king, and she's his queen. You see, and they're the king and queen of every species, and Yahweh set that thing up. You see, but my point is, the purpose got to come down. Now, we live in an Adam just like she lives in Adam. She's the mother of all living. He's the father of all living. And they came from the dust of the earth just like the animals come from the dust of the earth. But they got to come down. Look, the purpose got to come down through the man. And as you're coming down, you see that sun right there? You see that sun? You see, he points to the true sun, which is Yahshua Tzai, and he's the first Adam, and those two sons got to come down together. As he bringing them on out that guard, I'm letting you know that, okay, I'll sit down in just a second. And they come out that guard, those two sons are coming down.
You got 10 minutes.
You see?
Not really.
Not according to him.
I run the place.
In other words, they're coming on down out of the guard, and they're coming on down, you see, they're coming on down into that darkness. See, now when you come down to that darkness, you see, now, how can I say it? The man still knew who he was.
Uh-huh.
However, he had a condemned conscience in that he partook of the fruit, and he knew that Yahweh knew. However, he was not deceived. I'm going to get that out. 1 Timothy 2:14, 3:14, and I'll sit down and say
1 Timothy 3 and 14.
I think it's 2:14.
1 Timothy 2 and 14.
Yes,
and Adam was not deceived.
Adam was not deceived.
But the woman, being deceived, was in the transgression.
She was in the transgression, not him. He willingly laid down his life for us. Why? Because Yahshua Messiah is going to come down, you see, and die on his cross, you see, bury, resurrect, and dispense grace in this age. For us, who is his bride. And now, after his death, burial, resurrection, ascension, outpouring of the Holy Spirit, the woman, or Israel, which is his bride, is now clothed with the sun. And that moon, which is a type of darkness, because remember, the moon gets its light from the sun, the moon is now under his under her feet, or the law has now been put to death. And now, we are complete in him. I ain't got time to get what I want. I got to call one more scripture. Colossians 2 and 9. Then I'm going to sit down. Because I don't want to push for time. Why my watch is wrong? What time you got, Doc? What time I got?
It's on the cameras. The time.
What's
I have 1 hour, 57 minutes, and 50 seconds.
I got 50 recording. Seconds. Right?
You have 2 minutes.
2 minutes. Okay. Go ahead. Read.
Colossians what?
2 and 9. Remember, give it thanks to the Father who's made us fit. Hold it. Giving thanks to the Father who made us fit to be partakers of the heritage in light. And we have been delivered from the power of darkness, right? And all things was made for him and by him. We never got that read yet, but let's read that real quick and then it'll go there.
Colossians 2 and 9.
Read.
For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the supernal nature of Yahweh in bodily form.
Talk about Yahshua Messiah. Read on, please.
And ye are complete in him.
Me and you are complete in him. Read on.
Which is the head of all principality and power.
In other words, he's the head once he is formed in you. You see, he is the head.
Right.
You are the body. Mm-hmm. And he's dictating everything. The point is you have to become conscious of him in you. And when you do that, then you allow him to lead and to guide you and to direct you. Because he is the true compass in us. And you're going to find out that now that Joe Williams, who walked around in the flesh, is dead. But I appeared as Joe to you.
Right.
But in reality, I know now that I am Yahshua Messiah in the personality of Joe Williams carrying out the will of the Father. And that is him in me that is leading me and guiding me and dictating and running the show. And all I have to do is seek him, and I guarantee you with unequivocally, he will lead and guide you, and he will prepare the way, and you'll be made free. And if you think the rich, you think you're going to be rich, I tell you something, all the rich will come unto you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Well, I truly thank the Father for allowing us to hold class this morning. And we hold classes every Tuesday and Friday from 7:30 to 9:30, Sunday morning from 11 to 1. Fourth Sunday of every month, we have a Spanish class from 9:30 in the morning at 10:45. And if you want a copy of today's lecture, please see Kenaway after class.
Now, just a quick announcement.
Okay,
I made some MP3 copies of Dr. Kinley's lectures. It's on 3 discs. It's about the full collection of Dr. Kinley's lectures from 1959 to 1975. I pretty much got them all, so I haven't missed. So if you, they're available, and if you wish to make a free will donation, that's fine. Whatever amount, you know, we can make copies on the CDs. Yes. Okay, and we also have textbooks if you want to, on CD. No, I figured that out yet, but I'm working on it to see if we can get them printed somehow. But we do have them on CD, not only the 69 edition, but also God the Archetype. You can get that on the same, both of them on the same CD. Okay.
Very nice.
Hey, Reggie, make your announcement about, you're not going to be here next week.
Huh?
Make your announcement about you not being here next week.
Oh, I'll be back Friday. I just won't be here Tuesday.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll be here Tuesday. Going on vacation. Okay. And we wanted to thank our guests for coming out to visit with us. We hope you were here. I sure did. Enjoy your company. So come back again to study with us. Bring your friends and all your enemies.
Anyone that wants today's lecture, tell me right after class.
Already said that.
Okay.
Hey, already said
for one.
Okay. Okay. Let's make three. Take three, yeah. So come back again and study with us. Bring all your friends and enemies, and all donations will be accepted by our treasurer, Dr. Lloyd Lawless, and stand for the doxology. Now to him that is able to keep you from falling, present your falling before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both before all time, honor, the soul, say.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
When are you leaving?
We're leaving Tuesday.
After
death? No, we have leaves before.
Oh, okay.
We can't make it. The thing takes off.
Very nice to have you here.
Thank you.
And we hope to see you.
I work with more leaves than ever.
Did she make a copy?
No, I got the text.
I know, but she has to make a copy. That's the only one. She's got to make a copy. Is that the only one? You have to make copies. Make a copy. That's the only one.
What the? See, I don't know where everything is, but
I'm going to get you.
Oh, I'm
I hope this ain't going on the air.
Sure it is. Of course it is, madam. That's right. Even that zoom in. See, that's going on the air just as well.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. I think the boogaloo. Yeah. I don't think they do it no more.
Good morning. 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 Good morning.